Robert, over the weekend, do you have a chance to talk to Oscar or Bernard Hopkins or anybody?
Yeah, well, we're all weigh-ins and fight night and everything, so they're all around. So, yeah, we, like, hi, you know, after the fight, one thing that Hopkins, yeah, cool, Hopkins, a good drink. You know, like, I've said it before, I was never a real big fan of Hopkins, but...
He's a really cool guy, Robert.
No, and he's a legend, man.
He's a Hall of Famer.
Exactly, you know... What he did at his age, becoming a champion at the age that he did, and
starting. He was older than you. What he be? You're not 52
yet. Yeah, and you know that's why. So you got to admire stuff like that. Like I said, you know, I was never a big fan of his, but I know what he accomplished, what he did. He's a fucking legend. You know, one of the greats. But you know, after the fight, we were in the lobby. With Brad and Santillan's family, and Hopkins comes to me. He's like, he says, I would have never liked to go when he was fighting. He said, I would have never want to go against one of your fighters.
Wow,
yeah, you know, never want to go against one of your fighters. You know,
yeah,
he knows that my fighters go out there to fight. You know, can't win them all either. You know, when you're at times you have a good group of fighters, and you're. You're taking them, they're winning, you know, 4 rounds, 6 rounds, 8 rounds, they're winning, you got the right promoters, taking care of them, and then they become champions, they keep winning, but then comes the day where they have to lose.
We've seen it everywhere.
It happens to
cycles.
Everybody. You know, me as a trainer, I'm like, you know, like Freddie Roach, Salas in Vegas, Nacho Bedingstein, who? We prepare our fighters. We don't have those young ones that, you know, we already went through all that. You know, we already have all, you know, so many fighters that not all of them win. You know, Salas, you know, he's a great trainer. He goes and takes fighters and, they, you know, some lose, others win. You know, same thing with us. You know, we're there where now they have to fight. Now they're at the position where they have to fight. Or those that were young coming up to a point where maybe they didn't develop or they didn't become what was expected. But they still got to fight. They still got to fight, and now they got to take a chance. They got to risk themselves against a better fighter, and you go out there and try to pull off the upset. You know, that's the way boxing is.
And it's part of life.
Exactly, that's just the way boxing is.
Someone like Josecito Lopez, his career was up and down. Was in major fights, won some, lost
yes.
some. But fans love it and respect
yes,
it.
Exactly.
But most of the time, boxing fans, rather, when you lose one,
yeah, that's the way it is. You know,
it sucks.
It sucks. So that's only in boxing, but yeah, you know that's the thing about, you know, being a coach,
high profile,
so many different fighters, so many years of experience that, you know.
But Robert,
can't
on Monday you're a genius, on Tuesday you're the worst coach in history, Thursday you're a genius.
It happens.
It happens a lot. Where he's a great coach. Oh, he lost two.
Yeah.
But what do you mean you have tough fights, Robert? You're fighting guys of the best of the best, best pound for pound, best in the division. These are very hard fights.
Yeah.
So it's not realistic to expect.
That's why
it comes.
You know, there comes that point where you have to fight, and your fights are gonna lose. You know, there's many trainers that are new at this, and they got two or three solid fighters that can fight. They keep winning, win titles. They're winning, but then comes the day where they're gonna have to lose. They're gonna lose. Somebody's gonna be better than them.
And it happens. And you know what? The tougher the fights are, the chances of losing.
And then
is
also,
higher.
The more fighters you have, the more chances that you're gonna lose too. We have 30 plus fighters.
If you just had Mikey and you retired when Mikey retired,
if I just had Mikey and Bam, you know, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
When I had Nonito, you know, then
that's
then,
why some
yeah,
fighters,
they're not losing.
But Robert, isn't some fighters don't want a lot in their fight. They want to keep it to control. But look, you walk in here, you probably have 30 fighters right now. I haven't counted.
Yeah.
But they all have potential of being a champ.
And
nobody's
there's
here.
There's another 30 that are not here right now.
They're in Big Bear somewhere?
Some are in Big Bear, some are not fighting right now because they just fought or, you know what I mean?
And listen, you work hard all these years, and at the end of the day, I'm going to tell you something, Robert. You're not the one fighting. So as much as you could prepare them, you never know what goes through their mind.
That's true.
They could be out to launch. They could
not try.
They could convince themselves they're not winning.
That is true.
And you don't know that till later. You come back, what did you tell me? Oh, he wasn't eating. Right. He wasn't disciplined.
Yeah.
It's not easy being a coach.
Not easy.
You know, right now you have to be their friend, their teacher, their psychologist, psychiatrist, their babysitter, their mom,
There's also those trainers that have three or four fighters. They don't have that many. So they do training camps if they fight for the same promoter, they're training together at the same time, you know, so they could go to camp and the trainer could be focused on them. But I have, like you said, 30 plus fighters. I have my family, you know, I can't live with them 24/7 to a point where fuck, I'll lose my family. You know what I mean? I have to also, you know, they have to be disciplined too, you know. It's not just about me babysitting. The kids have to be professional.
But if they're young, Robert, boxers are not kids that have college degrees. They're street kids, a lot. Not everybody. So they may do some stuff that's not the smart. You've had it happen.
Of course,
sometimes there's accidents and bad things happen.
Always happens, man.
Yeah. It shouldn't happen. But here's the thing that's interesting too. If you were a fighter and you had to pick someone to coach you that wasn't from your gym, and I know your dad's sitting right there and he coached you, but if you were a fighter, what coach would you go to? Which names, Robert?
That would coach me when I was... I'd probably say Emmanuel Stewart.
Have you ever met him, talked to him?
I met him, yeah, but never really had a conversation with him. Yeah,
why would you pick him?
He was a great trainer, man.
Because he worked with everyone from Cotto to Chavez to Lennox Lewis.
Trainer. He built a lot of fighters from the beginning.
Tommy Hearns.
Yeah. So... I think he would have been a really good one. Also the way he trained, the way his fighters fight. You know, I probably would have liked to train and fight like that. You know, maybe not my style, but Nacho Bedingstein, really nice. You know, counter punching in and out.
Boxing.
You know, I think I could have fought like that too, but I was more into like I wanted to like fight like
Mexican style.
Kind of turn into like. Wars type of fight.
Nacho's a legend.
Yeah, but Nacho's
doesn't get his credit. Nobody mentions him a lot. But how many champions has he had?
I have no idea, but he's got, I believe he said like something like 29 or something.
Great sense of humor.
Yeah.
Like he's fun to be around. Like you look at him, you think he's dead serious, but he's a jokester.
Hey, yeah, he's a jokester.
Have you ever been to his gym?
Not in Mexico, not Romanza.
Has he been to your gym?
No, he's never been to my gym.
But he still
I know what his name, what those, you know, Romanza from the, you know, I know what, the fighters that he put, that he named his gym after, Gilberto Roman, another one that people don't mention a lot as one of the greats in Mexico, and that to me, one of my favorites, Gilberto Roman, and Roman Zaragoza, you know, a good fighter too, but Gilberto Roman, you know, one of my favorite Mexican fighters.
How old is Nacho now, about?
Nacho, I have.
He looks younger than his age. He must be 80, 90. I don't know.
Yeah.
But he's been doing this forever, and he has a very good track record. Anybody who trains with him loves him.
He does. See, the thing is that some fighters think, okay, I'm a pick Nacho to go train me. But they leave him because, oh, well, he doesn't do mitts. He doesn't – well, fucking some trainers don't have
– a trainer.
A trainer's the one that – trainer has somebody to do mitts, and they're the ones giving instructions. That's all you need. You need somebody that's gonna know how to work the corner, that's gonna know how to direct training, how to direct sparring. He doesn't have to be the one holding mitts. A lot of people think the trainer is the one holding mitts. It's not necessary, man.
Robert, does it make a difference if you have a big name in your corner? Just a name. Like if you go to a big fight, does it influence the judges? Does it influence the promoters? Does it influence the ref? Having a star trainer?
I think it could help. I think it could, you know. It could help. I think it could, you know. You know, it shouldn't, but I think it does. You know,
they're fans too.
It influences just the fact that you're signed by the promoter that's promoting the fight. You could be just a 4-round fighter. You could have your coach from the amateurs that nobody knows, but if they know you're the one that signed, you're the A side, the one that signed.
You already have an advantage.
You already have that advantage. So of course, if you're in the corner with somebody that you know. The fighter, the opposite corner's trainer is not well known. Nobody knows who it is. And then you have a very well known trainer,
that
and
they
the
know.
Fight's very close. They could favor it.